Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Curator's Distinguished Professor of U.S. Military History at Missouri S&T. And alongside, as always, are my good friends and partners in crime, April Cheek Messier and John Long from the National D-Day Memorial. How's it going today?
Wonderful. Hello, hello.
Doing great. Glad to be here.
Yeah, me too. This is always just going to be a lot of fun. We have an old friend of mine. This is Katherine Kate Landdeck, who is kind enough to join us today. We've known each other since we were graduate students at the University of Tennessee way back in the 1990s. And we were both in the doctoral program there. Kate and I both studied under just a wonderful mentor, Dr. Charles W. Johnson, who was just everything you could want out of a major professor, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Most definitely. I learned a lot from him.
Yeah, me too. And so Kate is really the world's leading expert on American female aviators in World War II, specifically, of course, the Women's Air Force Service Pilots, or WASPs. She has been heavily involved in you know, researching that side of World War II, and she's done more documentaries than I could ever even mention, but they've appeared on A&E and the History Channel. She's taught C-SPAN's American History Television lecture in history series with a lecture on American women in World War II. She's appeared on NPR. Published work has appeared in USA Today, The New York Times, The Atlantic, The Huffington Post, and then Kate, of course, is a full professor of history and director of an oral history project, the Pioneers Oral History Project at Texas Women's University. But most notably, she's the author of a remarkable original book called The Women with Silver Wings, which is, without any question, the best single source on the WASP. And also, by the way, not just really good original scholarship, but really well written, just a personal human story that's so fascinating, which I just couldn't recommend this book more. So, Kate, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thanks so much, John. You say so many kind things. I appreciate it. Thanks.
Well, it's well deserved, let me tell you. It's just thank awesome you. To have you here. So, if maybe we could just, the place to start with this, is to tell us a little bit about who the WASPs were, how this program comes into being, and what they did in World War II.
Right. Thanks for the chance to talk about the WASP and to tell their story a little bit. So, 1942, as your audience especially knows, things weren't going really well for the United States in the war. And we were behind, desperately behind, and needed more pilots. And so the Army Air Forces finally decided to go forward with an experiment of allowing women to fly their military airplanes. And the first place they needed more pilots was in the fairing division. You think about all those planes that were being built across the country in the factories. They needed to get from those factories to the points of embarkation. So you bring in women as ferry pilots, initially very highly qualified women, 200 horsepower rating, 1,000 hours average flight time, and you bring them in and have them start flying these planes. They initially limit these women to light trainer aircraft, Piper Cubs, Taylor Crafts, things like this. But once they realized these women could really fly, they let them move up the ladder of aviation, flying AT-6s all the way up to P-51s, B-39s, everything in the inventory. But then the Army Air Forces realized they could use more women pilots than just this small group of ferry pilots. And so they started a training program that went together with this idea of these other pilots. They ended up having 25,000 women apply because this was the golden age of aviation. Everybody wanted to fly. This was a great chance. But they only had room to take 1,830 into the training program, first in Houston, then in Sweetwater, Texas. But these women went through the exact same training program as the men. And then once they graduated 1,102 women in total have their wings. Once they get out into the world, they do all the other flying jobs that needed to be done domestically. Jacqueline Cochran, who is their leader, called them aerial dishwashers, right? Nobody likes to do the dishes, but they must be done. And she advocated the women pilots could do all that domestic flying that nobody really wanted to do. You could tow a target behind an airplane. You could fly the, you know, the base chaplain from base to base every Sunday. You could check the weather from above, test fly aircraft after they've been repaired. You could do all those kind of boring jobs, not glamorous jobs. And they advocated, okay, let's let the women do all those jobs so the men could be released for combat, which, of course, the women never were allowed to serve in at that time. So it was just an amazing opportunity for women to prove that they could fly and to serve their country in essential jobs.
Kate, can you talk a little bit about through the challenges that female pilots faced, and particularly in the beginning, too, when the programs were initially being set up and there was just something as simple as a uniform that fit and housing? And can you tell us a little bit about how difficult that was and how the women persevered through some of that?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the Army Air Forces didn't quite know what to do with these women. Of course, there were a lot, many of the men who weren't sure women could do this. This was, they talk a lot about this being an experiment. And several of the WASP would talk to me in later years and say, don't call it that. I don't like you calling it that. But it's all through the primary documents that the powers that be really thought this was an experiment to see if women could fly these airplanes. So there was that doubt, that constant having to prove themselves. No, I really can fly an AT-6. No, I really can fly a P-51. But yeah, those very basic challenges of, oh, well, what are they going to wear? Are they a part of the military? Are they not? Do they get a uniform? Do they not? What does it look like? Does it look like the men's uniform? Is it a special uniform? And housing, where are they going to live? And that was one of the biggest challenges on every base where these women served. There were over 238 bases across the United States where they served. And where were they going to live? Well, some bases they lived with the nurses. Some bases they had their own housing. Some bases they didn't live on base because there was no place for the women. When they first got started, the program was delayed a month because there weren't enough toilets for the women in the housing that they wanted to put them in. I mean, these very basic fundamental pieces of the equation that the military just wasn't set up for women. And then it certainly wasn't set up for women pilots. So it was a constant challenge. And these women, they were not prima donnas. You know, these were women who were there to do a job and put up with an awful lot, as I would argue many of the men at the time did, as the military was growing so fast. Barracks were not a happy place for many people. But then what do you do with the women, especially once they got on active duty and they were on bases where there would be two of them or four of them? That's an even bigger challenge, because what do you do with just a handful? So they definitely stuck with it and put up with a lot, and again, as so many did during the war.
Kate, describe for our listeners what the training regimen for WASP recruits was like. How did an average day go? How grueling was the program?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. The training that they went through paralleled the training that the Army Air Force's male cadets went through, right? They wanted this, again, the language that they use in these documents is an experiment. This is an experiment. And you know, and I'm sure your audience knows, everything was recorded during the war, right? It's, okay, we're going to do all this medical testing to see who's the best height, who's the best weight, who's the best, you know, all of those kinds of details. And they did the same thing with training. And if you're going to have an experiment to see if women can fly military planes, then you want to parallel what they do with what the men do. So their training completely paralleled what the men did. So they had to pass the same medical fitness test to get in. They had the same kind of academic type of testing. But then their day, especially once they got to Sweetwater, Texas, and things were kind of figured out and codified, their day would be split between half a day of ground school and half a day of flying, where they would, you know, they'd be in flights and they'd have coursework like math and Morse code, which they all universally hated, except for one woman who loved it, and everybody thought she was weird. But they would have an engines course. They had a weather course. They had all those courses that you needed to have as a pilot. And then, you know, by later in their program, they had a military protocols course. So they had all those same ground courses that the men had. And then they went through flight training, and that changed over time as well, where they would have basic primary training, basic training, advanced training. In the beginning, they had just a hodgepodge of airplanes, mainly civilian airplanes in those first months, until they could get on the list to get some of those military grade training aircraft. But they had calisthenics, which they universally hated, but you have to be strong to fly those planes of the day. And they were all athletic and healthy women. So it was really, it was set up completely to parallel the men's program. The one thing that they didn't do was formation flying, because there was no need for it. Though some of the ferry pilots did fly in formation, they didn't want them to do that. And then combat maneuvering, they didn't have any of that because they were never going to be in combat. And they did test the women and try to keep track of the women's menstrual cycles, because they wanted to determine if women could fly while they were menstruating or not. This had been a big issue in the 1930s. The CAA, which is, of course, the precursor to the FAA, had tried to ban women from flying while they were at that time of month, and 5 days before and 7 days after, which of course means women wouldn't fly. So they tried to test that with the women during the war, and they did not participate very well, did not cooperate very well, until they were assured that they would not be grounded during those certain days, and then they were able to participate. So the medical testing portion of this great experiment was a little different than the men, but otherwise they really worked hard to parallel their day-to-day lives to the experiences of the male cadets.
Yeah, so there's sort of two major types of missions: the ferry missions, in which you have to basically be checked out on the military aircraft. So mm-hmm. This is all the you know, the famous war planes of World War II that you're flying to and fro. The kind of mission that's always stood out to me, though, is towing the targeting sleeves. And I talk about this a lot in my classes, when I say, how would you like to be that pilot who's piloting an aircraft that's towing a targeting sleeve that a rookie gunner is trying to shoot at? And you know, if you've ever fired a 50 caliber machine gun, which is typically what you're going to train up as a gunner, I mean, that thing is hard to control, even if you know what you're doing. Mm-hmm. So I wondered, Kate, if you could maybe describe what a typical towing mission would have been like for one of the WASPs.
Yeah. And, you know, it was quite an experiment and an experience for these women. And, you know, you'd have the pilot in front, and you'd have a reel man in the back, and he would reel the target in and out. But then you would just fly the route up and down the beach, usually. So you think of, you know, you go to the beach today, and you have the little planes that fly the banners advertising pizza or whatever, kind of same idea. So the idea was, this is boring flying, right? It's just from point A to point B and back to point A, and kind of standard. But yeah, these guys on the ground, they were young, they were inexperienced, and they were flying with live ammunition, right? That's the only way they would do it. They would often color code them, right? They put color markers so they could see who was hitting the target and who wasn't. But yeah, the women would, they would fly down and get fired at. And while none of them were shot down, when you started to see the markers in front of the plane, you would often, you know, they would call it and say, you need to get these boys in line. I'm landing, and let me know when you're actually ready to start firing on the plane. Because it was, it could be quite unnerving.
Kate, did you find similar stories like the WASP in some of the other allied countries or other countries in general during? I know the British had the ATA, which is where Jacqueline actually started and got the original idea. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the Soviets, of course, had combat, women serving in combat as pilots, and those women are quite extraordinary. And well worth knowing about. They're obviously quite different from the experience of the WASP, who served just domestically. But yeah, in England, you have the Air Transport Auxiliary, who served as an arm of the Royal Air Force. They were technically civilians as well. And you have people from many different countries. Pauline Gower was the woman who pushed and got women involved in the ATA. But it was a much more international group. You have people from dozens of different countries that are serving in the ATA, including women. And these are mainly pilots who aren't eligible to fly for the Royal Air Force, right? These are the men are usually older. There was one who was missing an arm. They were just, for a variety of reasons, unable to fly for the Royal Air Force. And then, of course, the women. So you have the ferrying of planes within, you know, from base to base in the UK, and then eventually across the channel to France once the invasion had occurred. And you have women flying all different types of aircraft. And yeah, Jackie had been pushing and pushing General Arnold and others to let women start being trained in the United States. And he said, why don't you take a group over to England? And then you can learn more about their program and come back, and we'll get things started here. So she recruited a number of American women who and took them over to England, where they served under Pauline Gower, and did the same type of fairing work. We actually have a handful who came back to the United States after they had served there and became WASP, including Helen Ritchie, who is, you know, a great pilot of the day. So it was really a very different experience in that it was a war zone. You know, they had to avoid the barrage balloons and things like that. But the idea was the same of women serving in the war effort as pilots.
Kate, during the early years of the WASP, the media had almost a fascination with these female flyers. And yet, the way it's described in your book, a lot of it sort of cringeworthy by modern standards, I think. But what did the news media of the day get right, and what did they get wrong about these women?
Oh, that's a very good question. So the interesting thing about the media and the WASP is it changes over time, right? In the beginning, there was a flash of, oh, we're going to have women pilots serving in the Army Air Forces. And then it gets quiet, right? In the beginning, they're held up as these great heroes, and aren't they patriotic? And again, the cover of Look magazine and Life magazine, and aren't these cute little girls flying these airplanes and doing their part for the war, and shouldn't you too? The Life magazine spread. They went out to Sweetwater, Texas in the spring of 1943. And, it was spring and summer of 43, and they have a whole two-page spread of the women sunbathing between the barracks and out in their bikinis and things like this. And the cover girl they choose, Shirley Slade, a lot of the women wore their hair in braids, right? Because they have to put the helmets on, and it's windy, and, you know, it's a simple hairstyle. But, you know, they have her on the wing of the plane with, you know, she looks about 12 years old and is very, you know, and the title is Girl Pilot, which that was the vernacular of the day, but it was, they were often portrayed as girls having fun flying airplanes and doing their duty, but, you know, kind of simple. And then when there was the push from the Army Air Forces to bring these women into the military properly, right? Because they were brought in as civilians because nobody was sure if they'd be able to do the job. Then they realized they needed to cover the women with insurance when they died. And they needed to have the women be locked in. Because if you were serving in the WASP and you didn't like the base they sent you to, you could quit. If you finished your training and decided to get married, you could quit. Not many of the women did, but the armed forces realized, no, we need to, you know, respect these women. We need to give them insurance. We need to give them benefits. We need to make them a proper part of the military. And when that effort started, there was some pushback and against the women. And so there was a lockdown in the media about, we're not going to talk about these women at all anymore. And I think that's part of why they get forgotten. But the media that does get out is negative, right? These women are stealing men's jobs. These women are batting their eyes at the generals to get what they want. A really nasty, untruthful, unkind things being said about these women who were serving their country. Then when the WASP get disbanded in December 1944, the media is all happy about them again, right? So they've gone from these cute little heroines to these selfish vixens who are taking men's jobs to, oh, look at these great heroes that we're now sending home from the war. And I always like to expand this story about what the WASP and the media to the 1970s. They were not brought into the military in 1944 because of all sorts of complications. But in the 1970s, they have a grassroots campaign to become a part of the military and to be recognized as veterans, which they succeed at in 1977. But the media loves them in the 70s, and they're held up as these, spunky grandmas who had flown in the war, and aren't these old ladies cute? Did you really fly those planes, Granny? And that kind of attitude. So they go through this up and down cycle of how people think about these women and how they're represented in the media as non-threatening until they were seen as threatening men's jobs, and then they were bad. And then back again to being cute and harmless. And it's been a very interesting look at just the way the words that are used to describe these women has changed dramatically depending on the time and the place.
Yeah, and somebody who might have affected those attitudes and the coverage is, of course, the guy who really is the Army Air Forces on some levels, Henry Hap Arnold. The head of the Army Air Forces, who is an extraordinarily forceful and strong personality on a lot of levels. And initially, he's very much in their corner and pushes to create this program. But then he kind of just lets them twist in the wind in this sense, too. Mm-hmm. What's going on with Arnold? Why does that happen?
Yeah, I think, first, it's so interesting because, you know, I spend so much time looking at Hap Arnold and the work he does with the WASP. And then I take a step back and realize how much he was actually doing in the war, he's everywhere. Everything is like, how did you even have time to have a phone call with Jackie Cochran about these women pilots? I mean, it's just astounding to me. He even went and he and George Marshall, looked at the uniforms. Jackie had a display, had models come in and to help pick out which uniform. So it's like, what is going on? He really, I think, believed in these women pilots. He was their advocate. He did want them to fly. He did think that they could do this job. He did think Jackie Cochran was the right leader of them. But he also, again, I think had a lot going on. There was a lot of pushback in the summer of 1944 in Congress. Some, I think, personal against him. There was a lot of push in the media against the women. And the reality is by the September and October of 1944, when he makes the decision to disband these women and says, you know, okay, you guys have done a great job of serving for the last 2 years, but we no longer need you. Enough men are coming back from the war. I think he was very traditional in the view that women, of course, can be good pilots and are good pilots, but you can't have women being pilots and being separated from the men and a special project to a certain extent while there are enough men, you know. So to a certain extent, it was very practical for him, this ending of the WASP. And he supported Jackie Cochran and these women. His son, Bruce Arnold, of course, was a huge advocate and came and helped the women in the 1970s gain their veterans recognition. And Bruce Arnold always said that he was finishing Pop's work, right? That his dad had really wanted these women to be a part of the military, had really supported these women, and just wasn't able to get the job done, right? There wasn't the congressional will, the political will to do it. And so, you know, if you base his son's actions on, you know, as a guide, he really did believe in these women. You know, his actions during the war indicated he did. I think the disbandment of the WASP in 1944 and that kind of twisting in the wind, as you say, I think it was political and practical more than anything else.
Kate, I often try to put myself in the place of these women and think about the fact that 30 years after their service, they wake up to see headlines in a newspaper about the Air Force Academy deciding they're going to take women. And they make this big announcement that for the first time in history, women are going to fly military aircraft. I think how that must have felt to so many of these women. Did you see in talking with them that around that time, because a lot of them, they don't seem to have talked about their service as much, and maybe because it was painful in terms of not being able to do what they loved in the years after the war. But did that provide some impetus for them to begin talking about it and telling their stories?
Yeah, I think, you know, the thing that the women realized, there's a couple of things coming together here in the, you know, late 60s and early 70s is, you know, times have changed, right? The women's movement is very active. And at the same time, these women are getting older, right? They're in their 40s and early 50s. Their kids are going off to college or moving away. And so they have a lot more time than they'd had earlier. And then this realization that they'd been forgotten. You know, it's one thing to be dismissed, or but to be forgotten, and the work that you did to be not remembered, even by the Air Force, even by other women pilots, that they don't know anything about you, and that they don't know anything about the 38 women who died as WASP during World War II, that they'd been forgotten. And it really fired them up. You know, they knew they wouldn't get the GI Bill. They knew they wouldn't get the benefits that they would have had if they'd been veterans during the war or right after the war, but they just couldn't stand not being forgotten. And they were very savvy. Remember, this is a really well-educated, really smart group of women, very stubborn group of women, right? To be able to do the things they did in the 1940s. And so they used that, you know, they'd already been building and to push for that veterans recognition. And then when those announcements came out for the first time ever, they grabbed onto that. They had a whole system in place where they reached out. You can find newspaper articles across the country, national papers, local papers, where a WASP would call their local newspaper and say, now, wait a minute, hold on there. And so you can look at, you see in the newspapers, the announcement about women getting to fly modern military aircraft. And 2 days later, just as big or bigger spread on, oh, wait, in World War II, women did this. So it was this great opportunity, this great hook, and a huge inspiration for the women once they'd realized they'd been forgotten.
Kate, a lot of the last chapters of your book are describing the ways the WASP alumni struggled to get the post-war recognition you're talking about and status as veterans. Tell us a little bit about the congressional hearings and testimonies and how that all played out. And also, what were the successes and what were the disappointments of the process?
Yeah, I think that's great. I think, again, the grassroots effort of these women and the savviness of these women, they found allies in Congress. They found really important allies, including Barry Goldwater, of all people, which is always surprising because, you know, he's so conservative. He voted against the Equal Rights Amendment. He was not a person you would think would be a huge supporter of these women. And yet he was, because he had flown as a ferry pilot with some of these women. And he believed, you know, if I'm a veteran, they're a veteran. We did the same work. And so he was a huge ally for the women, helping push them forward. They found other allies in new positions. Antonia Chandler Hayes, Handler Chase, excuse me, Antonia Handler Chase, was a new higher up in the Air Force working on personnel, right, and recruiting. And they got her to testify on their behalf, saying, you know, if you don't recognize these women as having served and as having been good pilots and as veterans in World War II, how are you going to convince women today to serve in the armed forces? Remember, these testimonies were happening in 1977. This is post-Vietnam era. The military is struggling to recruit people. And she really pushed on, if you don't recognize these women, you can't recognize, expect women to trust you. So they were very savvy about the testimony that they gave and how they gave it. There was, of course, pushback from some different organizations, the national level, VFW and others came and testified against them, said that it would denigrate the name veteran if they made these women veterans, different kind of things like that. But then you have local chapters who wrote letters to Congress in support of these women. So it was really, it brought up the bigger question of who is a veteran, especially of that post-World War II era. And put this into context, this is 30 years after the war. So this is when the men who served in the war are in their 50s and thinking about their future and thinking about their past, right? That kind of middle-aged thoughtfulness that hits so many people. And who was a veteran? The fear of many who were opposed to the WASP being recognized as veterans was that it would open, one of the phrases that was often used was a Pandora's box of other groups who would fight to be veterans as well, who met similar criteria. And the WASP argument was, bring it on. You know, if they have the evidence that they served and should be considered veterans, that's up to them to fight individually for that. We're here for us. And take a look at what we did and our actions and expectations at the time, not just the women's expectations, but the military's expectations. In the end, when they were recognized, there were a couple of dozen other groups that were recognized at the same time, including the World War I telephone operators, the women who went and served overseas as telephone operators during World War I. They were finally recognized. And also the Merchant Marines were recognized. Now, this is limited veteran status. This is the way the bill was worded. It was for the purposes of the Veterans Administration. So there was a limit to the recognition. But it meant that these women, as well as these other groups, again, including the Merchant Marines, now had access to the VA, which as they all grew older was a huge deal. It also meant they had access to military cemeteries. And very importantly for the WASP was they could have a flag on their coffin. That was something that was very important for them, was to be able to have that flag. So it was a very dynamic and interesting fight for sure, but it shows what you can do if you stand on solid ground.
Well, and it's all happening too in the context of gender integration in the armed forces, sort of post-Vietnam. And I mean, you know, talk about hysterical. Go back and look at some of the editorials, some of the, you know, the arguments then, how if women, you know, are admitted to West Point, it's the end. It's the end for West Point or the Air Force Academy or the Naval. Like, we can't have this. And I think it's, you know, looking back kind of now, it's just so silly on so many levels. But that was the mindset. So they're running against that, too. You know?
Right. And the anti-ERA movement, right? You know, it had passed with, you know, Equal Rights Amendment had passed Congress, you know, by 100% practically, you know, in 1972. But you have Phyllis Schlafly and others who are pushing back with these exact arguments, John. And that's the environment that the WASP are fighting for this, too. So it's such a controversial time for what women will be able to do and not able to do. So, yeah, thanks for that context.
Yeah, and so significant, too. Yeah, so I want to explore a couple dimensions of this with you. Clearly to me, one of many things that sets your work apart is your own experience. Okay, so you're a pilot. So maybe, you know, just tell us how you think that informed your work. Like, how do you think that affected your perspective and how you came about telling this story?
Yeah, well, I appreciate that. You know, I'm a private pilot. I'm not a you know, professional pilot or anything, but I think my passion for airplanes mirrored the WASP's passion for it. So one of the things about this work and my work with the WASP is oral histories was central, right? There were no, you know, today Texas Women's University holds the WASP archives, and it's an incredible collection. If you want to learn more about them, they have tens of thousands of photographs, digitized letters, diaries, all these things. But the WASP had just designated them as their archive in 93 when I started doing my research. So there was nothing there. It was a nice idea, but there was nothing there. So I started kind of blind, but doing the oral histories, you know, getting the story and getting those dynamics for decades, you know, and following up. And when, you know, I spoke to these women, you could see as soon as they found out I liked airplanes, and then when they figured out I was a pilot, the whole conversation changed, right? Their voice would change, right? The octave would drop, and it'd be much more intimate conversation, and they would talk about the airplanes in a different way and say, well, you know, when you, you know, and it really changed the dynamics of those interviews. And I think, you know, Dr. Johnson, right, Charles Johnson, our mentor, talked about having those gatekeepers to let you into the community and to let people know you're okay. And that helped with that so much, where these women treated me as one of them, which is, you know, I look back now and I think, oh my God, I was so fortunate. You know, I was in my 20s when I started my oral histories with these women, and you know, now I'm not in my 20s. I reflect on how they must have perceived me. And I think I was very enthusiastic and I loved airplanes. And I did most of my interviews at air shows, because that's where, you know, I wouldn't recommend doing oral histories during jet days, though. That doesn't always go well. but it meant I could have better interviews, I think. And it also meant that when I talk about the planes in the book, I can talk about the planes in a different way than if I didn't know anything. You know, the planes are more central, I think, than they would have been. That B-29 story, I can understand better. And I've had a lot of good luck with the EAA, the Experimental Aircraft Association. And when I was at Tennessee, we did the celebration of flight, of freedom with the city of Pigeon Forge. And so I got to ride in a lot of these old airplanes and get to know a lot of them. And that helped, I think, in understanding the smells and the feels and in kind of a different way. So hopefully there's a different level of intimacy and the airplane is more central.
And that's exactly right, Gabe. The perfect word is intimacy. I mean, what really stood out to me, because we all see things through our own experiences and our own perspective, but I just related to it so powerfully. It was so poignant to me because you were a kindred spirit with these WASPs, and it was so similar to the way I felt with some, particularly with so many infantrymen over the years, that, like you said, you become part of this group. And the gatekeepers and all that, and then they figure out, okay, this person's okay, we can talk to this person. And then, well, I don't know, I mean, I know you found this out, you become a kind of central figure in the sense that now you're entrusted with their story. And boy, I'll tell you, it's quite a mission. I'm telling you, you have to take that very seriously, and I really think that shines through in the book. So powerful. Well,
I appreciate that, John, because it is, you know, the relationships evolved over time. And I always had, you know, my mentor, Susan Becker's, be careful, don't get too close. But
I had the same problem. I know. Right? And then Dr. Johnson told me the same thing.
Yeah, the same thing. But they trust you, and you spend 20, 30 years with them, and you are a part of them. And that trust is a weight we bear joyously, right? And I, you know, you can see that in your books, John, too, that this is something we take very seriously and very sincerely. And we don't treat them as heroes because they are humans to us. And I think that, again, comes across in your books beautifully. And I strove to put it in mine where, you know, I don't know. It's a very serious weight to bear to have them trust you so much. But it's such an honor to carry that weight.
Kate, I have a quick follow-up to that since we're talking about that. Then after all these conversations and interviews you've had over the years and so few are left with us, can you tell us how should women aviators or anyone in general remember the women with silver wings today? How should we?
Yeah, I think, you know, I would always end my interviews in the beginning with them about that. And they would say, we were first. that was their biggest thing. They wanted to be remembered as first. But I think, you know, I think everyone should look at them and, you know, related to themselves and the idea that these were women who were in a time and place that didn't encourage them to do the things that they did, but they wanted to serve, they wanted to fly, and they made it happen. And then they weren't allowed to do it anymore, but they continued with their lives. And I think they're a great example of perseverance, a great example of stubbornness in the right way, and a great example of if you work hard at something, you can make it happen. And if it doesn't happen exactly like you hoped it would, that doesn't mean it wasn't valuable. That doesn't mean it wasn't worth your time. That experience and that effort is always worthwhile. So, you know, Bea Haidu was a dear friend of mine. She would always end her talks with, go for it. Whatever your dream is, go for it. And so that's what I hope people can take from the WASP story.
It is. It's a story about following your passion in that respect. Mm-hmm. And of course, in the context, you know, of serving the country too back then.
Yeah.
But not letting these barriers stop you.
Mm-hmm. And attitudes, right? Some had, you know, some, they all had at least one parent who was supportive. But, you know, one woman, her mom refused to say goodbye to her, Marty Weil, her mom refused to say goodbye to her, refused to come down because she was sure she was going to kill herself and she disapproved so much. And another woman's mother said, loose women fly airplanes. You know, I'm embarrassed to go to tea with my friends kind of thing. But they, you know, they didn't let society say girls don't fly airplanes. They didn't let society say you can't do that because they did it because they knew they could. They were smart and they were talented and they worked hard. And, you know, so that social you don't belong barrier, they just ignored it and did what they wanted. And they, you know, they were true to themselves and they found their people. And I think that's great wisdom that we can learn from them.
Yeah, most definitely. Well, Dr. Kate Landdeck, Texas Women's University, thank you so much for joining us today. It's just been a fascinating conversation.
Thanks so much, as always. And thanks for helping me share their story.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. John Long, please tell us about our veteran of this episode.
Today on our We Salute You feature, we honor the D-Day sacrifice of Private Frutoso R. Chavez of the 116th Regiment, 29th Division. Chavez was born in Pecos, Texas in January 1922 to a Mexican-American family, eventually with seven children. Like many young men of his generation, high school was a luxury the family could not afford, and Chavez dropped out to help support his parents and siblings working in construction. In 1942, the U.S. was at war, and Frutoso Chavez received his draft notice. He joined the U.S. Army in November for the duration of the war. He was posted to the 29th Division, which was already in England at that point, as a private in Company E of the 116th Regiment. Before he left, he married Juana Fierro, and by the time he shipped to England, she was expecting their first son, Jesse. On June 6th, 1944, the 116th Regiment were some of the first invaders to land on the beach codenamed Omaha. Although the exact circumstances cannot be known, it seems likely that Frutoso Chavez never made it to shore or that he perished at the waterline and was washed to sea. But he gave his life beside 2,500 brothers in arms, leaving behind his wife, the son he'd never seen, as well as his parents and siblings in Texas. About 2 weeks later, an American patrol craft spotted a body floating in the waters off of Normandy. The crew attempted to recover the remains, but could not. They did, however, manage to snag the soldier's dog tag. It was Private Chavez. He was listed as deceased, and his remains listed as unrecoverable. After the war, U.S. interpreters began to comb through the countless captured German documents, and a mysterious form was discovered. In late July 1944, the body of an American soldier washed ashore near Wimereau, France, some 145 miles from Omaha Beach. German troops dutifully buried the remains in a nearby French cemetery, marking the grave with the name R. Chavel. That burial was afterwards relocated by American Graves Registration personnel and designated Unknown X-731. It took some years to discover that Chavel, the unknown labeled X-731, was indeed Frutoso Chavez. Research into tidal patterns confirmed that a body lost on June 6th could indeed have floated up the channel as far as Wimereau in the time allowed. An examination of the skeletal remains confirmed his identity. It was not until 1951 that Chavez's family had been notified and arrangements were made to return the young soldier, husband, and father for burial at home. Frutoso Chavez lies today in Santa Rosa Cemetery in Pecos, Texas, a testament to the often overlooked service of Mexican Americans in World War II. Private Frutoso Chavez, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
Wow. That's very moving. He's probably was killed near the Dog Green sector or in the middle of it, on Omaha Beach, close to Viraville. You know, so there's that base point. But also what strikes me is the return of the World War II dead program, in which families had the option after World War II, of course, to have the remains brought home. So 170,000 of these remains were brought home by 1951, of which Chavez is just one of them. You think about that. That's just mind-blowing, isn't it?
Incredible.
And it's still going on as DNA identifies some of the remains.
Yeah. Yeah. And I assume we'll go on for a long time now. Yeah. Wow. Well, one of many ways we're still affected deeply by World War II, right?
Absolutely.
Well, this has been just another fascinating, great episode. Dr. Kate Landdeck, thank you again for joining us. It's been a pleasure having you.
Thanks so much for having me. It's been a real pleasure for me as well.
Thank you, Kate. And please come visit us at the D-Day Memorial. We'd love to have you here.
I would love to come visit. It's on my short list.
Wonderful.
Yeah, it's a great place. You'll love it. Well, you can email our team at podcasts@dday.org. We love hearing from you, so please don't be shy. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, please subscribe to this podcast, share it with your friends, rate it, and leave us a review. Help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Take care.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation, email our team at podcast@dday.org.
It's no military secret that I love you. Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret,
well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I wanna give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.